we start again. So we start again. Did you think over this? Did you think over this? How do we find the inverse of ax plus b in S if a is not equal to 0? What do we need to show? Just think. What do we need to show? See, any other element in S will also be a linear. So any other element will also be a linear element. So we want to find something like this. Ax plus b multiplied by cx plus d should be what? 1 plus a multiple of our friend x square plus 1. This is what we want to achieve, because we want to show that multiplication of this linear factor by another linear factor is 1 modulo ideal generated by x square plus 1. Let us have our old friend ax minus b. See, ax plus b multiplied by ax minus b, you know it is a square x square minus b square. Okay? So if I subtract it from x plus x square plus 1, or if I subtract x square plus 1 from it, what do I get? But then I have to multiply by a square my x square plus 1. Then what do I get? Then I will get equal to minus a square minus b square. And I know that a and b are not a 0-0 pair. In fact, I know that a is not equal to 0, because a equal to 0 is already treated separately. Therefore, this is a negative non-zero number. Therefore, minus of a square plus b square has inverse. In fact, it is 1 over minus of a square plus b square in the set of real numbers. So what did we get? Finally. So finally, we have achieved what we wanted. We got that the image of f into g, now if I write my gx as ax minus b, then fx gx bar will be in the quotient. Mind you, x square plus 1 is 0, so the factor, this term will reduce to 0, will be congruent to minus 1 over a square plus b square, which is a unit in S, because it is the image of a unit. So what am I using? If u is a unit in R, its image in the quotient is also unit. That is again easy to check. Therefore, gx bar into fx bar is a unit, and in fact I can multiply by minus 1 over a square plus b square my gx and fx. If I take the bars of both of them, this will be equal to 1 bar. So what did I do? Look at the proof again. I took a general element in the quotient which is not 0. Because it is not 0, I can treat the cases a not equal to 0 and b not equal to 0 separately. First of all, any element in the quotient can be written as the image of a linear factor. Now that linear factor we will show will have an inverse. And then the final conclusion is that S is a field. So that is done. So we have proved that the quotient ring or the factor ring of Rx by x square plus 1, the ideal generated by x square plus 1 is a field, and this will be isomorphic with the original set of real numbers, because we showed that for any polynomial it either reduces to 0 or it reduces to a non-zero constant. Okay, let us move on to the next problems and we will see some more results which are interesting. What is the problem now? It is 23. Yes. Now, in 23, the ring is slightly different. Please note that. What is the ring? Our ring is now Zx. Polynomials again, but where are the coefficients? The coefficients are in Z. See, in the previous example, the coefficients were in R, real numbers. Now, the coefficients are in Z. So, be careful. And what is the ideal? This is my ring R, and the ideal that I am considering is the following. F x in Zx, and what is the condition? The condition is that F 0 is equal to 0, I think. Yes. So, what are the polynomials? Precisely the polynomials which have constant term equal to 0. How do you write the polynomial? A naught plus a1x plus anx raised to n, and f0 is 0. So, a naught is equal to 0. So, you can also express it as the set of polynomials which begin with a1x. Plus a2x square and so on, plus anx raised to n with ai in z now. There is yet another way of expressing the same ideal. That will be the ideal generated by x. Why? Because every element can be expressed as x into a polynomial. See, you can factorize. You can factorize every polynomial in this ideal and take the factor x out. So, there are so many ways of expressing the same ideal. Now, what are we supposed to do? Oh, we have already shown that I equal to x. But with the same example, we will be solving some other problem. I'll leave it there. Okay. Problem number 24. Problem number 24 is, consider A, the pairs of integers. So, they will be in Z plus Z with X, Y in Z. So, what is this? This is contained in Z, direct sum Z, but the first component is a multiple of 3. It's easy to see that it is an ideal. Then, what do you need to show to prove that A is maximal? Again, how do you characterize a maximal ideal? That it is not properly contained in any other ideal apart from the whole ring itself. Or you take the quotient of the ring by the ideal and show that the quotient or factor ring is a field. What will be the factor ring? Now, any m n can be written as what? 3r plus, okay, if it is or 3r plus 1n or 3r plus 2n, because any m is congruent to either 0, 1 or 2 modulo 3. So, there are only 3 possibilities. Okay. So, what are they? So, this is equal to 3rn or 3rn plus 1n. Sorry. Let us write down all the possibilities. Or 3rn plus, sorry, I have already added once. This is component wise addition. So, the only possibilities are 3. You can express it as just 3rn plus or, I'm sorry, didn't write very clearly, or 3rn plus 10 or 3rn plus 20, right. You can have this 00 if you like. So, what are the 3 possibilities? Modulo ideal. This element is in the ideal A. So, modulo the ideal A, every element has got 3 different images. So, this will be the 00, 10 and 20. So, these are all our R by A is 00 image, 10 image and 20 image, right. This is the total. So, there are only 3 elements in the factor ring. It is a finite ring. So, if we show that it is an integral domain, that is enough, because we know that a finite integral domain is a field. See, we have to use all the things that we have learnt. Okay, we have to use all the things that we have learnt. So, it is easy to check that this is an integral domain. We just built up the multiplication table. Consider the multiplication table. 0, 0, 1, 0 and 2, 0. So, this will be 0, 0 of course, multiply. What do we have here? Here also it is 0, 0. And here 1 into 1 is 1. So, that is not a surprising. 1 into 2 is 2. So, no divisor of 0. 1 into 2 is 2 and 2 into 2 is 1, because 2 into 2 is 4 and 4 is congruent to 1 modulo 3. So, this is, therefore, our ring R by A is an integral domain. Finite integral domain is a field. Or you can actually show that 1 0 bar is its own inverse and 2 0 bar is its own inverse. So, either way you can check that R by A is a field. So, it was not a problem at all. Next problem, number 25, is rather special. Why is it special? Because when you read it, you might wonder whether it is a problem in analysis or algebra. Because the space or the ring that we consider is the ring of continuous functions. Continuous functions on R, I think. Yes. But instead of R, you could take any closed interval, doesn't matter. Let me write down the problem. R is a ring of continuous functions from R to R. So from real line to real line, real valued functions. And now, it is a ring. First of all, I want to leave that to you, that check that it is a ring. Commutative and with unity. The constant function 1 is the unity. So, it is a commutative ring with unity. What ideal are we going to study? Consider the ideal I of all the functions in the ring, which are vanishing at 0. So, if you draw the graph of the function, it will pass through 0, 0. F 0 is equal to 0. Will you check that this is an ideal? It is a subring, is very easy to see, and also it is quite easy to see that it is an ideal. Because if you take product of two functions and one vanishes at 0, surely the product will also vanish at 0. So, check that this I is an ideal. You check that. Now, we want to show that this is a maximal ideal. Oh, he calls it A, doesn't matter. If I call I, doesn't matter. Show that this I is maximal. How will you show that? Now, the ring is infinite. Factoring is also infinite. So, our argument about finite integral domain being a field doesn't work here. Besides, this ring is not the usual ring of integers where every ideal is generated by a single element. See, the ideal generated by a single element is called principal ideal. You might as well know the term. So, all the nice results that you know about Z, Zx, etc., they are no use. But our ring is much, much bigger. It is the ring of continuous functions from R to R. The ideal we are considering is that of functions which vanish at 0. We have to show that I is maximal. So, what we will show is that if G is not in I, then we will show that the ideal generated by G and I together is the whole ring R. That is the standard way to show that the ideal I is maximal. Take an element outside I, adjoin it to I and show that the ideal generated by these two together is the whole ring. Which will mean that if I is contained in S contained in R, then S is either R itself or I itself. You cannot have elements outside I and S not being equal to R. So, this is what we will show. It is not difficult to show, provided you know your analysis rather well. Why? Because we are dealing with continuous functions here. So, the properties of continuous functions will come into play. Okay. Let G not be in I. What does that mean? That is G0 is not equal to 0. Okay. What is this ring like? What are the units? What are the units? I want you to check that the units in R are functions f such that fx is not equal to 0 for any x in the real numbers, because the units should have inverses, and 1 over f is defined as 1 over f of x is equal to 1 over fx. 1 over f is defined as this. And then you can see that 1 over f is the inverse of f. The product is 1. 1 is the unity. So, the units surely are the functions of f, which don't vanish anywhere. You can check. For example, that if h for any other x naught is equal to 0 for some x naught in R, then h has no inverse, because the product of the inverse and h should be 1, and hx naught into any other function v x naught will be equal to 0 for any v in the R. So, this will not be a unit. H is not a unit. So, what have we done? We have first characterized or found all the units in the ring. Okay? So, if I show that this bigger ring generated by G and I consists of a unit, I am through. Yes? So, that's what I will do. Is rather hard. We will show that the ring generated by G and I has a the subring generated by G and I, or the ideal generated by G and I, has a unit, because this will imply that the ideal generated by G and I is the whole ring R itself. How do we do that? We will get for G. See, G is fixed. G is a function such that G0 is not equal to 0. But we do not know anything about the values of G at other points in R. Remember that. And certainly G may not be a unit itself, because G can vanish at some other point. We have seen that a function which vanishes at any point cannot be a unit. So, it's very likely that G is not a unit itself. How do we find F? सगळे चॉक्स कसे वी विल फाइंड some f naught in our ideal I. Such that G plus F naught is a unit. How do we find one? We want to find a very special F, which is when I add to G, it will be a unit. So F plus G should not vanish anywhere. The same thing as saying that nu f naught plus g does not vanish anywhere on R. How do we achieve this? This is what I meant when I said that you need to know your analysis rather well. This example or this problem actually concerns both our ring theory as well as your knowledge of analysis. What can happen? What can happen for addition of two continuous functions? What do we want? We want the addition of two continuous functions. G is given. We only know that G0 is not equal to 0. G may have zeros somewhere else. And we will find F naught such that G plus F naught does not vanish anywhere. Shall we be able to do that? How do we do that? Okay, G is given, so let C, capital C, be the set of zeros of G in R. Now it is a very elementary thing to realize that C is closed. Because G is continuous, C is closed in R. And our point zero is not in C. All this is given. All this is given. So can we make use of that and construct F naught so that F naught plus G is not equal to 0? Yes, you can. You can use Urizon's lemma. Look it up. Look it up in a book on analysis. And you can get by Urizon's lemma. Why don't I get any soft chalk today? I'll take a small one. By Urizon's lemma, there exists F naught continuous on R, F naught not equal to 0 on C, and F 0 is equal to 0. Now see, now try to check F G plus F naught. If G vanishes, F naught does not vanish, and where F naught vanishes, G does not vanish. But what about the addition? It can happen that they both are of opposite signs. Then what shall we do? Then the addition can still be 0. 6 minus 6 is 0, 7 minus 7 is 0. But we want to have the function such that it is not equal to 0 anywhere. But there is a trick. If not g, we can take something. For real numbers, this trick is fine. Consider g square plus f naught square. If not g plus f naught, g naught, g square plus f naught square. This is not equal to 0 and in fact it is positive on R. So it's not exactly the sum g plus f naught, but it is a linear combination of g and f naught. Okay? Because this is g into g and f naught into f naught. So although I said we will find g plus f naught, I have found a linear combination all the same. Then g square plus f naught square is a unit and it is in the ideal generated by g and our original ideal I, which is the function, which is a set of functions which vanish at 0. So are you there? We did produce a unit in gi, not such that, not this, but the linear combination of this is a unit. This is what we managed to prove, and we have already got a unit in the slightly bigger ideal. Therefore, the ideal I is maximal. Okay? So, problems like this tell you that different branches in mathematics, they are still connected, and you may have to use results from one when you are tackling problems in another branch. Let us keep going. Let us see now problem 26. It has a different flavor. It has a different flavor, and I hope I find a good chalk. Chalk I have not tasted. Okay. That is problem 26. I hope you can see this. I simply cannot find any soft chalks today. Let me try this small one. 26 is, what is the ring that we want to consider? Z8 plus Z30. Okay, this is our ring in under consideration. What are we supposed to do? We find the maximal ideals. Maximal ideals in this. What are these? This has got 8 elements, this has got 30 elements. Z8 is integers modulo 8 and Z30 is integers modulo 30. So, what will be the ideals? The ideals will be ideals in Z8, direct sum ideals in Z30, because we take the addition and multiplication component wise. So, what are the ideals here? Ideals in R are J1, J2, where J1 is an ideal in Z8 and J2 is an ideal in Z30. So, clearly for the maximal ideal, you will need maximal ideal. J1 should be a maximal ideal and J2 also should be a maximal ideal. So, as we have found before, J1 is, J1 generated by some d, which is d is less than or equal to 8, less than or equal to 8, and the GCD of d and 8 is a prime. Similarly, J2 will be generated by the image of another R, so that R is less than 30 and GCD of R and 30 will be a prime. If the GCD is 1, then it generates the whole ideal. Will they be maximal in the direct sum? Will they be maximal? Not quite, because if J1, J2 are like this, then clearly J1 direct sum J30 is contained in R, and that is also a proper ideal. The maximal ideal should not be contained in any other proper ideal. So, what will be the maximal ideals? So, the maximal ideals in our ring are J1 direct sum Z30 or Z8 direct sum J2, where J1 maximal in Z8 and J2 maximal in Z30. So, what will they be like? I know that 2 generates a maximal ideal and 6 generates a maximal ideal in Z8, and similarly in Z30 also 2, 3, 5 will generate maximal ideals, and so will 9, because the GCD of that integer with 30 should be a prime. So, you can see how you get the maximal ideals in this sum. Identify the size of the field R by I. The size of the field will be then whatever that prime is here, the size of the field will be that prime. We have seen that the quotient will be ZD, where D is the prime. Okay, 27, that is another problem which gets you to look at what type of factor rings or quotient rings you get. 27. What is that? How many elements are there in ZI? Quotient by the ideal generated by 3 plus I. How many do you expect? It's finite. It is going to be finite. So, it is going to be a finite integral domain and hence a field. Therefore, this is going to be a maximal ideal. How do we show that? Consider I to be the ideal generated by 3 plus I. Then in the factor ring, 3 plus I image is 0, or 3 minus 3 is equal to I, but then take the square is equal to minus 1 equal to 9. This implies in the image 10 is 0. Okay? What is ZI? Zi is the set of elements A plus Bi, where A, B are in Z, the set of integers. So, what will the elements in quotient look like? What are the elements in the quotient? So, clearly I will have 0 less than or equal to A less than or equal to 9, 0 less than or equal to A less than or B also less than or equal to 9, because 10 is 0. All multiples of 10 will be 0 in the quotient. We can reduce Zi modulo ideal generated by 3 plus I. Now, will it have really 10 by 10 size, or will some more elements from here be equal to 0? We have to check. I is equal to minus 3. We have to check. Let us check. Now, if A plus IB bar A1 is equal to A2 plus IB2 bar, all A2, B2 lying in this range between 0 and 9, then what happens? Then A1 minus A2 bar . So is this possible? Is this possible? Or I can say that if I multiply by 3 plus I, if I multiply it by another element, that should be equal to 0. Or A1 plus IB1 is equal to A2 plus IB2 plus a multiple of 3 plus I. But the multiple of 3 plus I will always give me, if I have the modulo the ideal, 10 to be equal to 0. So how do we check that there will not be any other elements which are equal to 0? We already have this, I is equal to minus 3. So let us substitute and check. So what do we have? A1 minus A2 will be equal to 3 times B2 minus B1, minus 3 times. So, what does that give us? That shouldn't give us a contradiction. You should be able to deduce that if A and B both lie between 0 and 9, the only choice will be A1 B equal to A2 and B1 equal to B2. How do we deduce that? And how do we check that you will not get any other solution between these two? Okay, we will write down, won't proceed this way, but we subtract and get A2 minus A1 plus I into B2 minus B1. This will be 3 plus I into, so I am just bringing yes, I am bringing this here, and it will be 0 means it will be 3 plus I into some other R plus SI. Okay, so multiply. So what do you get? 3R minus S plus I into R plus 3S. So what do you get? B2 minus B1 is equal to, in fact this I can just reduce this by take any element here. I will just say that A plus IB, I reduce B2 minus B1 and I get this. So what do I get? I get A to be equal to 3R minus S and B is equal to R plus 3S. So what is this? S is equal to 3R, no, this is not quite what I wanted, but it does give a contradiction unless A1 is equal to A2 and B1 is equal to B2, but although I had checked it, I am just making a mess somewhere. What is the mess? A equal to 3R minus S and B is equal to R plus 3S, that's fine. Yes, A minus S is equal to 3R, yes. So that A and S are same modulo 3 and B and R are 0 modulo 3. There is a way to get a contradiction, and we will reduce next time. I'll check it on this because I think I'm just confusing in which equations I need to use, but we will deduce that for this the only solution is that A1 is equal to A2 and B1 is equal to B2. So the size of the quotient is 10 multiplied by 10 equal to 100. So the quotient or the factor ring will have 100 elements, and a finite integral domain will certainly be a field, and therefore this ideal is going to be maximal. I'll just check it next time. I'm just making a mess in checking up these equalities. Maybe you can try it and you will get it before I do, but otherwise on Friday I will check on that and then we will go ahead. Okay, let me just indicate something for the next problem. Problem 28. Yeah, now we come back to the similar problem that we have already tried. This is much similar to what we tried in 25. So problem 28, and now the page is changed to 57. The ring is ZX. Polynomials with coefficients in Z, and what is the ideal? Ideal is the generated by F with Fx equal to 0. We have seen this before. This is equal to the ideal generated by X. And then what are we supposed to do? Show that I is not maximal. See, we showed for continuous functions that the continuous functions which vanish at 0, they form a maximal ideal. But we come to another ring, that is the polynomials with coefficients in Z, and there again we are considering precisely those polynomials which vanish at 0. Those polynomials where the constant term is 0, or those which vanish at 0, and here I is not maximal. So we find an ideal S which is properly contained in ZX no equality here and no equality here, and so I will not be a maximal because I will be contained in a bigger ideal. So what will that be? One example is the ideal generated by x and a constant 2. So those will be precisely the polynomials with constant term which is even integer. Now that properly contains I because the integers 2, 4, 6 are also in S, not in I. And this is not the whole ring of polynomials because it does not contain polynomials with odd constant term. So this is, therefore I is not maximal. Can you extend this example and find some more? Can you find some more examples? Surely. If I write SP to be equal to the ideal generated by X and an odd integer P, an odd prime P, then again SP properly contains I and not equal to ZX, but it is properly contained in ZX, and therefore that will also be a proof that I is not maximal. There are quite a few ideals in fact between S, I and R. Okay, see you next time, and I will complete this little problem that I made a mess of. I'm sorry.